So as I mentioned, one of the first examples of a tuning system that was adopted was by Pythagoras and in the early Greek cultures. And so we have what is called the Pythagorean tuning. So if we look at how Pythagoras tuned his scale, what he would do, he would start with really a preference for the purity of the 3-2 ratio perfect fifth. So what he did, he tried to start with a C, for example, and he would tune the next note up a pure 3-2 ratio perfect fifth. Above that gives us the G. If we were to go a pure 3-2 ratio above that, that would give us the D. If we drop that down an octave, that gives us a 9-8 ratio partial. And then up from perfect fifth above the D gives us the A, which then is a 27-16 ratio. A perfect fifth above the A gives us the E, which is a 81-64 ratio partial. And then we go up to the B, is a 243-128 ratio partial. So now we see in the Pythagorean tuning, when you keep a preference for the perfect fifth, the 3-2 ratio, let's look at what kind of intervals emerge in that scale between the various pitches. So we saw that, that between the C and the D, we do end up with a 9-8 ratio. Remember, that was the same ratio we find between the ninth and the eighth partials of the overtone series, which in modern equal temperament, we also have another way of measuring an equal tempered major second, which we'll come back to in a second. But we talk about the half step in equal temperament as being 100 cents as a unit of measurement, C-E-N-T-S. So when we talk about equal temperament, we're going to be talking about each half step as 100 cents or an octave being 1,200 cents total. So if we want to think about how these intervals here compare to an equal temperament, we can see in this chart here that the large major second, the 9-8 ratio major second that emerges in the Pythagorean scale, is a little bit larger than our equal tempered, which this one's 204 cents. So slightly larger. So then the next interval between the D and the E in the Pythagorean tuning is also a 9-8 ratio second, the same 204 cents. But then look at the between the E and the F, which is a half step, it's a 90 cents, which is quite a bit smaller than our equal tempered half step. So that's one of the issues that emerges here is that we have this much smaller half step here. Then going on up the scale, we go back to our 9-8. Second here between F and G, between G and A, we also have a same kind of whole step. Then A and B the same, and then we end up once again with this 90 cent ratio half step between B and C. So what the Pythagorean scale provided was, it provided a consistency perhaps in the seconds that were here. They're all the same size seconds. It gave us the preference for the perfect fifths, which are maintained. But also, once you start trying to do, say, fifths between any of these pitches, which have these smaller half steps, you would run into problems. So if we were to, for example, if we were to keep going up half steps, perfect fifths, if we were to go up chromatically, all the way around the chromatic scale by half steps, Pythagoras just stops with the first seven pitches. But if you keep going on this, and it'll take you 12 different perfect fifths before you finally come back to a C. Except the difference is you don't come back to the pure C, you come back to something about a quarter step off. And what that is called the Pythagorean comma, because the difference between seven octaves up versus 12 perfect fifths, which gets you back to the C, each time they don't line up. So the difficulty of the Pythagorean comma, that sort of quarter step, was sort of a conflicting sound that people have tried to avoid. So that was one of the issues with Pythagorean scaling and tuning, was to you could only go up to about seven notes, or else you start getting into these difficulties between different pitches. All right, so that's the Pythagorean tuning. We don't really find too much music today that adopts this kind of tuning system, but it is an interesting sort of idea to maintain the perfect fifths as the idea. Now let's take a look at another tuning system that is referred to sometimes as the Ptolemaic tuning, also called the just intonation tuning more commonly. Just intonation is much more aligned with the tunings of the natural overtone series. So if we were to take a look at the pitches of the scale that we see here, obviously the C is the same kind of scale, the C, and there's our octave, which is a 2-to-1 ratio. Then remember the overtone series, after the second partial, we get the third partial, which would be the G, which is here again a 3-2 ratio partial above the second overtone. Then going up, the fourth partial gives our octave. The fifth partial is going to give us the 5-4 ratio. Remember, that was the fifth and the fourth partials gives us that interval. And then as we look at all these other pitches, they are identical into the lowest pitches we find of these in the overtone series. And then we have the B is a 15-8 ratio partial. Now, look at the intervallic relationships that emerge once we follow the pitches off the overtone series. Then we start to see a very different kind of intervallic relationship between these pitches. So remember up here in the Pythagorean tuning, we had this one large major second, which is essentially 204 cents. Which comes out to be a 9-8 ratio. So in the just intonation tuning, what we find is the C to the D is a 9-8, but like the overtone series, between the D and the E, we find a 10-9 ratio major second, which comes out to be 182 cents, which is quite a bit lower than the 204 cent second, the 9-8 ratio. So now we end up with this two different kinds of major seconds that I was talking about earlier. Then we see the 16-15 ratio minor second between E and F, which is also from the overtone series. Remember, the overtone series maintained that to 112. So it's a much larger half step than we would find in the equal tempered half step. Then we're back to F and G, gives us the 9-8 ratio. Between G and A, we are in the smaller 10 to 9 ratio, 182 cents. Then back to another 9-8 between A and B. And then back to the same 16-15 ratio half step between B and C. So here you see two different kind of major seconds occurring, but we do get a minor second which emerges out of the overtone series between E and F and between B and C. And these are a little bit larger than the equal tempered minor second. So go back up to the Pythagorean, and we remember that the half step there was a 90 cents, which is a little bit less than the equal tempered half step. So here we see a whole different kind of scale system emerging with this. It's important to remember that in these scale systems, where this issue becomes much more problematic is once we have polyphony. We talked about the different kind of textures in music where you have monophony, which is just a single line moving along. And as you'll hear when you play some of these excerpts in this webpage, you don't always detect exactly the differences in these tuning systems when you're hearing just a single line melody. That they will have some impact on defining where the tonic feels most restful and so forth. But you don't get any major conflict until you start trying to put these on top of each other in either a polyphonic or a homophonic texture. Remember, polyphony or polyphonic texture is two or more lines running equally against each other. That was the first kind of texture beyond monophony in the Western music, where we have a whole several hundred years of Western music that moves us into polyphony, most commonly used in the 16th century in a vocal polyphony, and then later in the 18th century in more keyboard kind of harmonic structures. So when you get to homophony, then you have melody with accompaniment. So this idea of vertical structures of the harmonies that are emerging in Western music from, say, around the late 16th century forward, then this tuning system or the tuning system that you adopt is a critical factor in whether you can create consonant kind of structures. So let's move on down now. We see the just intonation tuning system was quite popular for a number of years in the West. Has its some problems, but it did allow for some consonants of certain pure major thirds that we didn't have in the Pythagorean tuning. But we don't also let go of the perfect fifth as being a factor there. Now, mean tone tuning is the next one. Mean tone tuning really was an attempt at trying to move a preference to have a major third that was preferenced over perhaps the purity of the perfect fifth. A lot of composers were interested in using the major third as a preference, and this perhaps started in the 15th century. If you look at some of the Italian composers, Josquin des Prez, for example, started to preference using major thirds over other intervals as kind of a new language that was emerging. But it wasn't clear how we would tune that for a long time, and how do we develop a tuning system that allows for the major third sound, which was being preferenced, to emerge in a kind of sort of a consonant way. So the major third that sounds best perhaps is the 5-4 ratio, which comes out of the overtone series. So the mean tone temperament was a tuning system that in essence preference the major third, we keep the purity of the major third, but we also wanted to have a way to divide that third into two different kind of major seconds. It takes two major seconds to build up a third. So if we have two major seconds, we wanted to get rid of this difficulty of having two different size major seconds that we would see in the other tuning systems. So what it mean tone tuning temperament does is preference the major third, but also how you calculate the major second is now dividing that major third exactly into half. So when you take a major third and divide it exactly into half, you do that by taking a square root of the major third, which gives you then one size major second, which is not really based upon any of these other kind of ratios out of the overtone series. So when we look at what happens in a mean tone tuning system, we see down here the 5-4 ratio third is kept preference. And then if you divide that into half for the D, then you end up with a major second that is 193 cents from an equal tempered standpoint. But you see all the major seconds are all the same size in this. And then we have 117 cent half step. So we're back to a consistency now of all the seconds are the same, and then all the minor seconds are the same. But what the compromise on this system is, we lose the purity of the 3-2 perfect fifth. So in some ways, the mean tone was shifting away from keeping the 3-2 ratio perfect fifth as a pure tuning system, and then preferencing more a consistency of major seconds and the purity of the major third. So in some ways, the mean tone temperament was a way forward into equal temperament, which equal temperament is the one I mentioned before that we adopt today. In some ways, there are no pure intervals from a natural standpoint in the equal tempered tuning system. It's a compromise of all these notes so that we end up with a way to calculate every pitch is exactly the same distance apart from each other. Just as we were trying to do in mean tone tuning, theorists were trying to find ways of making all the seconds exactly the same size but keeping the major third into a consonant sound. So the equal temperament is a system that has emerged around the world, and it's not just a Western construct. There were many Chinese scholars and theorists going all the way back to 300 or 400 before Common Era, where you find people exploring the idea of equal temperament. And there's some speculation that equal tempered as a concept was adopted by an Italian, Giuseppe Zarlino. Was an important Italian who started exploring the idea of these systems, and many other theorists. But China was doing it about the same time with many important theories. So there was a lot of experimentation going around the world trying to find systems for equal temperament.
The preceding program is copyrighted by Emory University.